Cyberleader bellowed that name again into the snowy city. Doctor. But nothing but an echo from his voice came back. The Silver Army gathered more Mondasians from the crowd and marched them into the fuzzy and foggy daylight for conversion. These Cybermen were not evil. They were converting Mondasians, believing themselves to be the saviours of Mondas and their species from a natural disaster. The Cyber Leader took a small step forwards from the remaining crowd to look around, scanning the fog for any sign of the foremost mentioned Doctor. The Doctor, with his new eyes firmly locked on the Cyber Leader, didn't hear the stomps approaching his position, where he was quickly grabbed and made to stand upright and marched into the screaming crowd in his torn and battered clothing. The Cyber Leader walked around the army looking at those collected for conversion and came across the Doctor with a sense of confusion. He didn't recognise this man as Mondasian and placed his hand against the Doctor's chest for a couple of seconds and detected a rhythm of four, the heartbeat of a Time Lord. The Doctor, panting, looked at the Cyber Leader right in its cold, dead eyes, and the Cyber Leader ordered his soldiers to march him into the conversion building in front of them. The Doctor was marched off the street, and while the rest was cleared of humans, and then silence fell. The Doctor woke up pinned to a table with cables around his wrists and ankles, clothing almost removed apart from his underwear and his valuables on a nearby table. His valuables consisted of a pocket watch, a yo-yo, a Barbie doll, two hairpins, a red pen, a compass, the sonic screwdriver and a red fire engine toy. While observing his surroundings, a Cyberman walked in, quickly followed by the leader he'd seen a few moments prior. The Cyber Leader, with his cold, dead eyes, looked the Time Lord up and down and asked him what he was. The Doctor froze, thinking about his reply. They know he's not Mondasian. No, he's something else. Does he admit it here and now and live with the consequences, or does he lie? During this time, the Cyber Leader asked again. The voice sent shivers down his new spine and gave the Doctor flashbacks to all his previous encounters with these creatures. The Doctor introduced himself as John Smith, a Mondasian just like them. The leader, puzzled with this remark, commented on the rhythm of four inside his chest, and the Doctor quickly dismissed this as an error on their part. John wants to be converted, he told them. He wants to upgrade to their program to survive. John tells the Cyber Leader about the collapse of the atmosphere, which startles the leader, as it was not common knowledge. At least that's what he thought. The leader walked over to the items found in the Doctor's possession and selected one at random. He picked up the broken pocket watch and looked at it very carefully, like he'd seen it somewhere before, and places it back on the table. He picks up another, this time the compass, and places it back again on the table. The third time, he picked up the sonic screwdriver and the Doctor's heartbeat start to elevate. The Cyber Leader knows that this alleged John Smith values this item. What is this? What is this item? The Doctor tells him it's a sonic screwdriver and please do not press that button on the sign. The leader walks over to the Doctor, taunting him, and proceeds to press the button, which releases one of the clamps around his left wrist. The Doctor, now free, punches the Cyber Leader, and he ends up falling flat on the floor. The other Cyberman approaches him, and the Doctor uses the sonic screwdriver and disables the Cyberman, causing it to collapse on the floor as well. The Cyber Leader goes to get up, and the Doctor hits it with a chair, knocking it cold on the floor. He grabs his item and clothes and quickly exits the interrogation chamber, now looking for the TARDIS. Sirens begin to howl through the old concrete corridors of the installation. Over the tannoy, a human-esque voice shouts that a prisoner has escaped. Security doors begin to slam shut throughout the installation, echoing back to the Doctor. Looking around for his way of escape, he quickly notices that his surroundings were getting darker and darker, and escape less likely. running down the corridors, barely making it through the security doors before they closed. His route was becoming more confined and remote. He could hear the stomps through the installation. They were coming for him. He looked up and noticed that a vent in the ceiling, but he couldn't reach it. The security doors either side opened, and marched into the corridors came a horde of brand new Cybermen. The doctor was surrounded. He looked left, he looked right, and he looked left again, and he was awaiting something to happen. The anticipation was growing by the second, asking them point blank what they wanted and what they were going to do to him, but silence was the only thing he heard. This was strange, he thought to himself. Something was wrong. What did they want with him? He approached one of the Cybermen slowly, and with a humble touch, he reached out to him, and he placed his hand on the chest plate of the nearest Cyberman to him. The Cyberman dropped his head and then raised it back up and looked the doctor straight in his eyes, and the doctor staring right back at him. He took the sonic screwdriver and opened the chest plate like he did back in the cave. Organic components mixed with machine again. Inside the chest plate were the six numbers 4, 8, 15, 16, 23, 42. The doctor looked up again with tears now starting to develop in his new eyes. The Cyberman lifted its hand, which was a different size and colour from almost like a Frankenstein type monster. It had been sliced and diced and put together for the seemingly greater good. The Cyberman clutched the doctor's hand and said something no Cyberman had ever said before. The Cyberman looked at the doctor and said, "Help us."